spoke with my mouth when I was in trouble. I will offer you sacrifices of fat beasts and with the smoke of rams. I will give you oxen and goats. Come and listen, all you who fear God, and I will tell you what he has done for me. I called out to him with my mouth, and his praise was on my tongue. If I had found evil in my heart, the Lord would not have heard me. But in truth, God has heard me. He has attended to the voice of my prayer. Blessed be God, who has not rejected my prayer, nor withheld his love for me. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
First reading is from Acts. Paul stood in front of the Areopagus and said, Athenians, I see how extremely religious you are in every way. For as I went to the city and looked carefully at the objects of your worship, I found among them an altar with the inscription, to an unknown God. What therefore you worship is unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, he who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in shrines and made by human hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all worlds life and breath and all things. From one ancestor he made all nations to inhabit the whole earth, and he allotted the time to their distance and the boundaries of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God and perhaps grope for him and find him. Though indeed he is not far from each one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being. And even some of you don't feel close have said, for we too are his offspring. Since we are God's offspring, we ought not to think that the deity is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of mortals. While
little while the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me, and those who love me will be loved by my Father, and I will love them and reveal myself to them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks
nice, clean hearts, O God.
And sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
O God, you have prepared for those who love you such good things as surpass our understanding. Pour into our hearts such love toward you, that we, loving you in all things and above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Give us this day such blessing through our worship of you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
O God, you have made of one blood all the peoples of the earth, and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Bring the nations into your fold. Pour out your Spirit upon all flesh, and hasten the coming of your kingdom. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Is this not the very thing we told you in Egypt, Moses? Let us alone, and let us serve the Egyptians. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die here in the wilderness. So this famous line, spoken by the Israelites at the climactic moment just before their epic crossing of the Red Sea, is the first of countless ones on a similar theme. Throughout the years of Exodus from Egypt and journeying toward the Promised Land, Israel repeatedly complains, that they had it better in Egypt. Apparently, in the world of the human psyche, predictable slavery is preferable to wild, unpredictable freedom. It seems to be a human tendency. Looking backward is always easier and more central event or theme of our faith. Resurrection is the central event and theme of our faith. And resurrection and resuscitation are two very different things. Resurrection has several key features that differentiate it from resuscitation. The first and most obvious is that while resuscitation involves staving off death, resurrection requires that we walk headlong into it. If we want to experience resurrection, we have to be willing to cross certain bridges and then let them burn behind us. Now, the second feature is that while resuscitation essentially restores life to what it was before a critical event, resurrection is an awakening to new life. Life that looks and feels unrecognizably different from what preceded it. We see this clearly in the resurrection account found in the Gospel of John. Mary Magdalene turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? For whom are you looking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Until she heard Jesus' voice speak her name, Mary did not know that it was her teacher, her Lord, her friend that stood right in front of her. And so it always is with resurrection. When whatever we have loved deeply, be it a person, a thing, a tradition, an era in our lives, is dead and gone, we will not likely recognize it immediately in its immortal and glorified form, even when it's right in front of our noses. In today's gospel reading, the one in which Jesus promises us the Advocate, the Holy Spirit of God, we heard it loud and clear. We must allow that which we love to go away and die. Then, and only then, will the Advocate come to us and open our eyes to the truth that something even greater and more glorious lies before us. And what an opportunity we have to practice resurrection right now. So much seems to be dying. Our ways of working and worshiping, our ways of finding recreation, our ways of being family and community, all of it is changing. And it is looking more likely by the day that in at least some ways, these things are never going to return entirely to the way they were before. So what are we to do in such a time? First, we are to show ourselves ourselves who weep and mourn at their passing. And then it is our job to wait in expectancy and hope. Because we know something that Mary Magdalene didn't. We know what happens next. Everything and everyone we have lost, we haven't lost forever. They are coming back in a form immeasurably more glorious than the one in which we knew them. It is our job, with the Spirit's guidance, to perceive them when and where they show up in their resurrected form. To make this point entirely concrete, let's look at our life as a church. The earliest bits of the conversation around reopening are beginning to happen at both the local and the global level. We don't yet have a timeline for this, but at some point in the not too distant future, such a timeline will become apparent. There is so much about this that is still uncertain, but there is one thing I believe is entirely certain. When we reopen, our life as church will not, and probably will never, look and feel exactly as it did before the outbreak. The events of the past several weeks have changed some things permanently. As the details of this become apparent over the coming months and years, our work is to practice resurrection. It is not at all wrong or unreasonable for us to mourn the loss of what has been, but we cannot stay stuck there. We must move on to a resurrected church, one that will look and feel different from anything we ever knew before. It may be one that has a dynamic and flexible combination of gathering online and in person. It may be one that meets almost exclusively in small groups and does so at a variety of times, not just Sunday mornings. Every aspect of its life, liturgy, music, prayer, education, outreach, are probably going to be done differently than they were before. And friends, this may be the greatest gift that God has given us in our lifetimes. Perhaps this resurrected church will be able to do what the old one seemed unable to do. To be meaningful, attractive, and relevant to the society of today and tomorrow rather than history. Now, this is scary. I know I don't relish letting go of a familiar past and going into a wild and unfamiliar future any more than anyone else does. But we are living in times that offer us no choice, and that may turn out to be an incredible grace because it brings us straight to our core truth. We are not a people of resuscitation. We are a people of resurrection.
Amen.
Amen. body, mind, or spirit. Especially all nurses, doctors, police, and fire. And especially Brad O. and Brad S. Give them the gifts of courage and joy in their work, and protect them from all adversity and harm. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, this congregation gathers together as a people made clean and whole by your grace, and desiring to know ever more deeply the power of your resurrection. Bless all its members with the gifts of hope, wisdom, and compassion. Pour out a special blessing upon these members in our weekly cycle of prayer. John and Gail T., Xavier and Felix, Nikki T., Steve and Lana T., Linda T., Aaron U., Sue B., John W., and Haruka K., as well as those in military service, Aaron B., Jody B., Abigail M., Valerie M., Amber R., Christopher W., and Taylor W. Risen Lord, hear our prayer. We pray also for all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit, especially those who have requested our prayers for healing and wholeness. We pray for Abe, Alice, Olivia, Amber, Anna Marie, Ashley, Audrey, Becky, Betty,
Christ,